Well, church, y'all ready to get to the Word? Get your Bibles out. And if you would, go to, let's see here. Go to the book of 1 Peter. We'll start there this morning. 1 Peter chapter 3. And let's just pray this morning before we get into the Word. Father, I just thank you for your Word. Your Word is life. Your Word is truth. And you said, Lord, that it's the words that leap from this page and touch our hearts that change us. And so I pray this morning, Father, that it's not my words, but it's your words. It's words of power, words of faith, and words of much assurance that touch the people's hearts this morning. Lord, I thank you for the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit to be here. And that, Lord, that our eyes will see things we've never seen, and the revelations will change our life like have never been seen before. And, Lord, I thank you for that, and I praise you for that. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. I want to read this to you, 1 Peter chapter 3, starting verse 8. It says, "Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another. Love as brothers, be tenderhearted, be courteous, not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing. Know that you were called to this and that you may inherit a blessing. For he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are open to their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who will do evil. Now, you know, a lot of times we read the Word like that. And, if you just read it and you just, for face value, and just read it, and didn't know anything about the Word, you may not know that Peter was, the last part of what he was talking to the people there, he was quoting from Psalms 34. And something I want you to understand, in the New Testament, we read this many times, and what happens is that they didn't have a Bible. They couldn't go down to Walmart and pick up one, all right? They didn't have, the Word of God is everywhere. I mean, nobody has an excuse as, well, I never had a Bible. All you got to do, literally, they're in Walmart right now. You can go buy a paperback for $3 or something, or $5. I don't know how much they are, but they're not much. You know, there's a Bible everywhere. There's a Word of God sitting everywhere. It's sitting on shelves. It's sitting all around everywhere. And it's a Word that if a person read it and in faith, as they read it, it has the ability to leap off, touch their heart, and change their lives. But so many people pass it by. So many people walk right by it. So many people never look at it. So many people that they hear the Word, or they may have been raised in church, and they may know Scripture. Something that's real familiar, like John 3:16 or Psalms 91, you know. They may know these things. And I guess all of us, in a sense, are guilty of this. I, as a young man, heard Word, in church, and things stuck to me in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, but I never even sought out who the Holy Spirit was. Heard the preacher say that every Sunday. When he closed, he'd say, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, but I never even thought about who the Holy Spirit was, right? Not until I started reading the Bible. We hear these things all the time. The Word's going around, and this is what, it grieves my heart, because I know, because it happened to me, that anybody, I don't care who they are or where they are in life, has the ability, if they open that Bible and read it, that God, it's supernatural. I don't know how to explain it. He has that ability to take that printed Word and it leaps off and gets into your heart, and you're like, and it changes your whole perspective in life. It changes everything in life. And it's sitting right there. We go in there and we buy food, we buy groceries, we buy clothes, we buy all the stuff. But the most important thing in the world that's sitting there is hidden on the back shelf. It's there, but you got to look for it. Hello? And America's got to change. American people have got to change. We got to quit arguing about the Word of God. We got to quit trying to take God out of everything. And we got to get back to the Word, because the only thing that's going to set people free is the Word. Because me trying to tell you, and you just taking the opinion of Robert Richards, isn't worth a hill of beans. All right? But me telling you what the Word of God says has the ability to change your life if you believe the Word of God. That's why this is years and years ago, I was talking to Brother Ivan, and I said, yeah, well, there were some people complaining about what I was preaching. He said, well, what were you preaching? I said, well, you know, I was preaching. He said, were you preaching out of the Bible? I said, well, of course I was preaching out of the Bible. He said, you weren't preaching out of the Reader's Digest or something like that? I said, no, I was not preaching out of the Reader's Digest. What do you mean preaching out of the Reader's Digest? And he said, well, if you're preaching the Word's going to go out and have an effect, so don't worry about it. You see, you can never go wrong with the Word. It doesn't need to be your opinion. That's why I will never argue religious matters with anybody. How much water you're supposed to use, how often you're supposed to take communion, how much you're supposed to do this. Because that doesn't mean anything to me. Now I'll argue the Word. Somebody take and twist the Word. And I say, oh, buddy, you're twisting the Word. You're pulling it out of context. It's not what it says. Let it be confirmed in two or three places in the Bible so that you know that that's the Word, right? Now I'll argue that all day long. It's like my own father was. I had to argue with him one time. He was telling me that I was too vocal and I was too loud and I shouldn't be preaching like I was preaching. And I said, well, Daddy, you know, that's just I'm supposed to preach. That's what I'm supposed to do. He said, no. He said, the Bible says God helps those that helps themselves. And so I thought about that. I heard that. I thought about it. And I said, wait a minute. So I went looking, digging for that word, that exact quote. Where's that scripture? And I found it. Ben Franklin said it. That exact quote. So I went back to my dad and said, well, Daddy, you know, there is a principle over in the book of James that says a man should do good works, but the Bible doesn't say it. That came from Ben Franklin. And I mean, he didn't like it too much. But I want to stick to the Word. Amen? So when Peter's preaching, he's trying to convey a point to the people. He goes back to what he had in that day, the Torah, the scrolls of the scriptures of the Psalms. I don't know how he had it. I can't tell you that this morning. I don't know. I mean, they didn't have many scrolls. They didn't have an iPad. They didn't have a book. He either had heard that, maybe he went to the synagogue and they quoted it, and he memorized it, or he actually went to the synagogue and rolled out the scroll and found, you know, where it was. I don't know how that happens. All I know is that he was quoting Psalms 34. He was taking the people of that day that he was preaching to, and he was going back to the Old Testament, the Word of God, and then putting it into the people so that then that would have life to them and bring them revelation. Y'all with me? You can't go wrong with the Word. Listen, folks, just stay on the Word. Do not argue church doctrine. Argue the Word. Amen? So I want you to go over to Psalms 34 this morning. Because while I was looking at this, see, that was just the little appetizer. That was the salad. Okay? Because it didn't have anything to do with what I'm preaching now. That was just the salad to get your hunger going. Okay? So you may want to write this down. The title of this message is Open Your Barn Doors. Open Your Barn Doors. Okay, so Psalms 34, I want to start reading a verse 1. Psalms 34, 1. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. This is King David writing this Psalms. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. And this is a whole other side note here. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. In other words, we're bragging on something. We're bragging on Jesus, not how good we are, right? The humble shall hear it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. That's what we were doing just a minute ago. We just fulfilled Psalms 34 right there. We're all standing here singing his name is Jesus. And let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. Everybody say all my fears. Anybody ever in here had any fears? You know, have y'all noticed here lately? I don't know if it's here lately. I don't know. I haven't really deducted this yet. Whether I have just gotten older and wiser and thinking more about, you know, having an understanding of the world and what's going on. If it was this bad back when, you know, my parents were my age. I mean, there was a Cuban Missile Crisis. There was missiles sitting right over there at Cuba pointed at us, and, you know, people were building bomb shelters, so there was a time of fear. But, you know, it just seems like everywhere you go, I am so sick of the commercials, the some of the talk radio people, some of the things going on, that it's just doom and gloom. I mean, literally, it makes it to like you don't have any reason to get up tomorrow, because if the banks don't go broke or the world doesn't go to pieces or there's not some, you know, weapon of mass destruction loosed or this or that or the other, it's like, oh my God, you know, we'll never make it. Do y'all feel that way sometimes? It almost feels like there's more fear being preached than faith, right? Okay, so he says, I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him, and he saved him out of all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him. Hello? The angel of the Lord encamps around all those who fear him. Folks, listen to me. We don't even realize at times of our life what's happening around us in the supernatural, that you just don't see it. I mean, is that true? I mean, do angels encamp around those who fear him? Or did God just make that up to just sound good and David just threw it out there and we're just supposed to say, oh, isn't that sweet? Or is it true? How do you know it's true? The Word says so. We're going to have to believe the Word, right? We have to have faith in what the Word says. So whether you see angels encamped around you or not, say, oh, that's spooky. I don't know. I don't know. I like it. I mean, the other night I was coming home late from work and I was driving down the road. And I was driving for about an hour and a half down the road and it started out, a javelina ran out in front of me. And then it was a hog and then a fox. And then two coons, and then, you know, numerous whitetail. And I thought to myself, I was driving around, all I need is a coyote next. And then I would like, you know, have the majority of animals of South Texas have tried to hit me tonight. But, you know, glory to God, I missed every one. Why? Well, I'm always praying and believing angels to be around me. I'm praying and believing God that you know, he's getting them out of the way or whatever's getting out of the way, then I want to get from point A to point B safely. If the angels are encamped around me, they might as well be doing something. I don't need them for decoration. The Bible says in Hebrews 1 that the angels are ministering spirits sent to those who are believers. So, I mean, if they got a job to do, then get them doing something. He said, well, I just don't know about that. Well, then know about it. Read your Bible and know about it. Don't take my word for it. Go find it. Go get you a Strong's Exhaustive Concordance. Look up the word angel and look up everywhere that's written and then go study it out. Do it for yourself. Okay? But that's something that I think is very cool. And it says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Okay. As I was reading this, my heart just leapt to the word fear, because I'm not a negative person. I'm a positive person. I'm usually always believing God to deliver me. But I have this tendency that when I hear a bad report, or even if it's not a bad report, if it's just a report, sometimes I can take it off in my mind and I can run with the imagination in the worst case scenario. Like I told my wife, maybe I ought to quit the ministry and I should go to work for a company who just says, look, we're going to start a company in this town, and so I want you to just think of all the bad things that could happen to us. I said, okay. I can do that. You know, this could happen, this could happen, this could happen. You know, I mean, I have it all. I could dream it all up. These are the bad things that could happen to you. And a lot of it comes from, because there has been some disappointments in my life, some things that happened in life, okay, that it's kind of a blow. And then so I it's like I said, I'm not really thinking negatively. I just think, what could go wrong? And then I stop and I back up and then I begin to pray about it. And it's okay to be calculative and things like that. But when it gets to a place where it's fear, like, in other words, something's happened in your life and you've prayed for God's deliverance in it and you didn't see it come about like you thought it should have. So then within your life and within your heart, there's a place of fear that the next time you run into a situation or you're going to pray, that you may not see deliverance. Years ago, we were doing bull ridings. And so we had put on a big bull riding right here in Utopia. And some of y'all may remember that. It's probably the last big flood we had. Because we were doing the bull riding and we were running it off. And we were supposed to do the bull riding. And then afterwards, we were going to the park, into the pavilion there, and we were going to preach. And it was all set up. I had guest speakers in there. It was just going to be a great night. And a young man gets just literally stomped by a bull in the deal, and they had to haul him off the EMS. And then before we ever got to doing the preaching, the bottom fell out, and it rained like you've never seen rain around here, and flooded the whole thing out. And I went home that night discouraged and said, "Lord, what in the world? Did you fall off the throne or what? How could it be raining? This was a great event for you. How could this take place? What in the world?" I stood out there, I rebuked the storm, and it just poured on me. And it took me a while to get over it. But it's something in life that there was a fearful thing. All I'm saying is sometimes in our life we take and we let those fearful things build up. What's interesting is this word, fear. If you look up that word fear in Psalms 34 there, and you look it up, and one it comes from two root words. The first one means terror, which obviously fear is a good translation. The second part of the word, it means a barn or a granary or storehouse. And I'm like, it doesn't make sense. If the Hebrew word, you're walking up and you're saying, "Oh, I'm so full of barn." Right? I'm thinking, how does this work? It doesn't make sense to me. And I got to looking at it. And the Lord stopped me. So he says, because fear can get so large in your life that you literally have to have a barn full of it. And I begin in my mind to see this image of a barn, an old barn. And you know how we do? I don't know if you're like I am. I always think I'm going to need something that I have someday. Anybody else like that? I wouldn't call myself a hoarder, but if I've got something, and I'll say, I used it, but there's half left. I think, I might need that someday, and so it goes somewhere. Hello? Or I hang it on the wall. And I tell you, if I throw it away, the next day I'll need it. I can keep it for 10 years. But if I get rid of it, the next day I have a use for it. So in my barn, I got a lot of things hanging on the wall. Stuff underneath here and there and whatever, And then after a while, it kind of gets to be cluttered. And then you kind of got to go through and start to do some evaluation because you either have to build a bigger barn to move the junk out of that barn into that one, or just abandon that one and go to another one. Are y'all with me? And it can get ridiculous. But wait a minute. What about our lives? What I began to see was, as I began to see our lives being that way, that whenever you've had a setback, whenever you've had something that caused you fear in life, that if you don't discard it, if you don't let the Spirit of God take care of it, what you do is you set it back. It becomes a memory. It becomes a part of your life that's just, it's kind of in the back. All that junk in my barn, I own it. I bought it. I paid for it. I don't see it. I don't use it. And then sometimes I'm digging through. It's like, I forgot about this. My son and I were looking for an impact wrench. And I said, "I know I got one." I said, "I got an impact chisel. I got one. I know I do." He said, "I've never seen one." And I said, "Well, I know I got one." So, never could find it. And I used something else, which is probably something I shouldn't have used, but I'd used something else. And then one day, here it was, pops it open, and my son calls me and says, "Hey, I was moving some stuff around. I found that impact chisel." See, I knew I had it, but was it doing me any good? It still didn't do me good. I'd already used something else by the time I found it. I hadn't used it yet. The point I'm saying is that so many times in life we put back these memories, we put back these hurts, we put back these fears, we stick them in the barn, we hang them on the wall, and there's something within us thinking, yeah, I need to keep that. We make it a memento. We make it a trophy. We make it something because we think someday it might be of use to us, but I want to tell you here this morning, you need to clean your barn out. I want to tell you here this morning, you need to get your doors open. And you need to let the Spirit of God come in and clean your barn out because it's too full, it's too cluttered. You got too many things you're stumbling over. It's hindering you from walking. It's hindering you from running with Jesus. It's hindering you from letting the good things come in. Hello? How many of you men, you got a metal pile in the back of your barn? Yeah? Yeah? And it's every cutoff piece of anything that it was ever a drop that you think you might use someday. And you throw it out back and you pile it up and then you tell your wife, hey, that stuff's worth something. I mean, if I wanted to, I could load it on a trailer and I can haul it. But you would never load it on a trailer and haul anywhere because you know it's too valuable to you. So it actually has no value monetarily because you're not ever going to sell it. Your wife will sell it the day after you die. She will collect on it. That's the way it works. And there's every now and then a rare occasion where there's something in that pile you do need. And then that just builds more in you the confidence for having the metal pile. If you don't watch it, what happens to you is it works in reverse on you. If you're keeping a fear as a memento in your barn, then when something happens that's like it or similar, then it reinforces you. You can't turn loose of it. Because if you let your guard down or you let your walls down and make yourself vulnerable, see, I did need that. I should have kept it up because they hurt me again. So we end up with a barn full of fear. You remember when a message I've been preaching to you about Peter in the boat? And when I was looking at this, I got to thinking about that story too, and I thought, you know, isn't that funny? Because Peter, it doesn't say Peter's the one that said, Lord, we're perishing, but he was in the boat with them, and he had deducted from all the rest that the boat was going down, and they're perishing. His imagery at that moment was they were going to die. Why? Because he had probably seen other boats in similar situations that had sank. And people that had died. And he might have even himself been in one of those situations before. And so he went back to his barn full of fear and said the same thing that he had always said, we're going to perish. But that day, Jesus introduced something new. Peace, be still. And the seas calmed down and the waves ceased. You see, that day, Jesus threw a monkey wrench in what was going on. Because that day, Jesus did something that they had never seen done before. And what I'm telling you today is, church, it's time to get out, to throw open your barn doors, to let the Spirit of God come flowing in so that you can be set free from those past images and live a new way. A supernatural way. Live a way that the power of God can be moving your life. And yes, it's risky. Because you're having to make yourself vulnerable to Jesus. But I want to tell you something, folks. If I'm going to be vulnerable to anybody, I trust Jesus more than anybody. If I'm going to make myself vulnerable and say, Jesus, I'm believing you for this, that you're going to do something here, I would rather be vulnerable to Jesus than trust any man on the face of the earth. If he's willing to die for me, willing to give his life for me, I'm pretty sure he's not just going to be mean to me and let me just suffer. That there is a reason, that there is an answer for what's going on. Amen? So, you can go look at this if you want to. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. It's a scripture that says that we're in a war. We're in a battle. Okay? But it says the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal. They're not fleshly. They're not... You know, have you ever thought about this, folks? The human body is an amazing thing. It has the ability to heal itself and, you know, all these great things. But have you ever really just thought about it in the animal kingdom? We're not really got much tough hide or claws or anything to match up with anything in the animal kingdom. Of all of the animals in the kingdom, we're the least resilient. We ain't got much. Your skin's not too tough. Y'all with me? Only thing we got are thumbs and a mind. And that's not, you know, that's not too good of weapons when a tiger's chasing you. Right? He says they're not carnal. They're not fleshly. They're not weak. But they're mighty in God. For the pulling down of strongholds and the casting down of arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. He says there's a way. There's a power on the inside of you that when fear comes upon you, there's a power to cast down the fearful thought and go to the powerful, almighty God thought. He says there's a way to do it. Right? Why would he say that? They're not carnal. They're not fleshly. But they're mighty in God. But the key is in God. They're not mighty in you and mighty in your strength. Because I want to tell you something. We had another message about this here just the other day. Talking about, you know, you can't defeat those thoughts when they're coming towards you. If you just try to yourself to defeat them. But wait a minute. You're doing it wrong. Why fight with that? I don't want to go fight a lion with a spoon. Choose your weapons and I choose a spoon. Why would I want something like a spoon to fight a lion? I want a 370 H&H or something, you know. I want the biggest beast of a gun that I could possibly get my hands on. You with me? I'm not going to go mess around with a spoon. Why would you want to be fighting the thoughts and the fears of your life with a spoon? Let's get mighty in God. Let's learn something today about getting your barn emptied. Let's learn something today about how big and how great and how awesome God is. So go to Psalms 24. Psalms 24, verse 7. Psalms 24, verse 7 says, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in." Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Lift up you heads, O you gates. Lift up you everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Folks, what you've got to do is you've got to come to the place that you want to get rid of your fearful mementos, your fearful imagery, your fearful ways, your fearful mishaps, the things that have happened to you in life, and you're ready to throw open your barn doors and say, "I want the King of glory to come in. I want the Lord God Almighty to come into my barn. I want to focus my imagery on the God who creates heavens and earth. I want to put my mind on the Jesus who loved me so much that he went to the cross for me, that he bore my sins, but he bore the pain and the suffering of the cross. He endured so that I could be free." That's who I want to look at. Listen to me, folks. The devil gets us so twisted and gets our tail so twisted that we're running around all the time listening to him and his fearful thoughts and his fearful imaginations, when the truth of the matter is, if Jesus was willing to do that for you, don't think he wants to deliver you right now? You're going to tell me? I mean, let's just say Jesus was dying on the cross today for us. Put yourself right there in the place. You're going to tell me that he was willing to die for you when you were a sinner So now he's not going to save you even though you're still a sinner? You're going to tell me you're going to let the devil pull the wool over your eyes and say, oh, well, he was willing to die for the world then, but now he's mad at you because you haven't been doing good. You see that thinking? You see that religious thinking? And it comes a lot of times from stupid preachers who don't know what they're talking about. And they get up in the pulpit and they preach garbage and they say, well, your problem was your prayers are not being answered is because sometimes God says no. And, you know, you've been doing wrong things, so therefore your prayers are hindered. Oh, he'd die for you. But he's not willing to come up in here and walk and bless you and help you and forgive you now. You see, the devil loves to get you into that thinking. Because once you're in that thinking, you're not in faith, you're in fear. I don't do everything right. I make mistakes myself. But I guarantee you what, I'm stepping off planet Earth and blazing through the gates of heaven. Why? Because I'm a preacher and I'm so good? No, because I know what the blood says. When I got the blood on me, man, I'm headed to heaven. I know what the blood says. The blood says I'm redeemed. The Bible says that according to Colossians 1 and 22, that I'm holy and unblameable and unreprovable in the sight because of the blood. So why am I standing in a barn full of fear? Why are you letting fearful thoughts come into your mind? Why do you think that when you hear the bad report, that the bad report is true and it's going to stand? Why do we listen to the bad report? And even meditate on it. Say, oh my God, that's going to happen. Oh no, I don't know. Oh, instead of saying, you think that could beat me? Who is the King of Glory? He's the Lord God Almighty, and I got a barn full of Him. You see what I'm saying, church? We let the devil beat us. It's like, he is the best trash talker I know. I mean, he's the best trash talker in the world. He just comes up and talks trash to you. He ain't going to do nothing. What about the King of Glory? Do you know, let me just read you the definition of King of Glory. Okay? Glory. That word there, it says the King of Glory. It means glory, honor, glorious, abundance in riches, honor, splendor, glory, dignity, reputation, reverence, glory, glory. Hey, that's pretty awesome. He's the King of Glory. I mean, think about it. Come on, think about it. He's the King of Glory. I mean, what makes you in life say, glory to God? What would make you say that? What event would have to take place to make you say, glory. He's the King of it. It's not a name. You follow me? King of Glory is not a name. It's a description. He's the King of Glory. Are you getting it? And he wants to come fill your barn. But if there's no place for him, where does he sit? You got no chair. Your table's full of fear. I don't want it anymore, church. I don't want to waste my time, waste my energy, spend my emotional energy even thinking on the fearful things. It's not worth it. It's just not worth it. It's time for us as Christians not to just be Christians in pretense. Not to just be Christian by name or by letter or, oh, we go to Living Waters Church or, oh, we go to the Methodist Church or, oh, we go to the Baptist Church. No. That we are the children of the King of Glory. That we face the obstacles of life with faith, saying, God, all I know is you're the King of glory. All I know, Lord, is, man, it can't eat me. And if it does, it ain't going to taste good. All I know, Lord, is greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world. I'm not telling you there's not going to be any hurts, there's not going to be any pains, there's not going to be some obstacles. I'm not going to tell you you're not going to have a few flat tires on the way. If there's going to be some heartaches and some headaches, I'm not telling you that. I'm just telling you if the King of Glory is with you, listen to me, folks. I mean, we have not got to the place here in America yet where we're being taken and putting in the lion's den. And I really pray that never happens. All right? Because I don't think y'all, I don't know how I'd react to a lion chasing me around the arena. Somewhere along the line, I'm thinking I'm going to lose it and get mad and start throwing sand and rocks and cussing or something, you know. You with me? I mean, you know, it just, I don't know. This is pretty rough. But you read the stories in the Roman times, the herd of the Christians in there for a Sunday afternoon thrill-seeking event, and that the Christians would go in singing all the hymns and the lions would eat them. Doesn't seem like much deliverance, does it? Or does it? They got out of a real rotten place and into glory in a little bit. It's like I always said, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody ever wants to die. You ever notice that? Everybody wants to go to heaven. Everybody wants to be with Jesus, but nobody wants him to come back or they don't want to die. It doesn't make any sense. Right? I've told this story before. I think it's number 36 in the register of Robert Richards stories, but it always impressed me so much. It was like one time, R.W. Shambach, a real famous minister, he was telling the story, and I was listening to him, and he said that a woman came up, and she was insistent. She said, Brother Shambach, I want you to pray for me. I just want to be closer to Jesus. I just want to be closer to Jesus. And so he laid his hand on her and says, Father, I just pray right now, just kill this woman. And she jumped back, knocked his hand out of her head, said, what are you talking about, man? And he said, well, you said you want to be closer to Jesus. You can't get no closer than to be in heaven with him. No, I'm not talking about that. And he said, well, listen, ma'am, if you want to get closer to Jesus, you know, you need to do what the Bible says. You need to read your Bible. And I can't pray you get closer to Jesus. I can pray you die and go to heaven. But see, we say that, oh, Lord, I just want to be nearer to you. Oh, God, I just want to be right with you. Oh, Jesus, I just want you to be there with me. Okay, well, then there's a way to get there. Oh, no, not that. So, folks, we've got to grow up and we've got to mature. We want to have the King of Glory on the inside of us. We want to be able to stand up and say, I declare in the name of Jesus, you stupid body, you're going to work. You're going to function like God created you to function. You say, well, I don't know. That's just, go read your Bible. Find out what the Word says. Find out what the King of Glory wants to do in your life. You see, we've got to be Christians. And Christians aren't full of fear. Christians are full of faith. That's why they're called believers. I mean, really, that's kind of a funny term because we call ourselves believers. Oh, yeah, well, he's a believer. But then when you really start and look at how many times you're really believing and how many times you're doubting, the doubting, so, you know, we're really like doubters / believers. Y'all follow me? I'm not trying to hurt your feelings or anything. I'm just preaching to myself, too, here. How many times I look at the situations in life and I'm thinking about, wow, that didn't look good. Instead of saying, well, you know, greater is he that's in me and he that's in the world. King of Glory is going to step in. You're not messing with a normal person. You're messing with a guy who's surrounded by angels. Do we have that kind of faith? You know, is that where we were walking? Or is it just religion? Is it just what, you know, you don't have to scratch this very far, and then, you know, you find out that what's underneath the religion? I would just so much rather go into heaven. The doors come open and I meet Jesus, and he walks up to me, puts his arm around me and says, "Robert, you are the craziest sucker ever on the face of the earth. You were believing me for things I never even would have done. I mean, you pulled the scripture left and right, stretching faith, believe me." I'd rather Jesus say that to me than walk up and say, "Oh, Robert, you finally got here. I'm glad I can finally do something for you because you never asked me." Right? I mean, I've always been like that. You know, even as a kid, my daddy can do that. I want to be that way. I want to be like a little kid. Say, "I don't know, but my daddy could do it. My daddy can do that. My daddy can fix that." I want to be a believer. I want to walk as a believer. I want my first reaction in life to be one of faith, not one of doubt, having to then work myself into faith. And the reason why is our barns are full. Our barns are full of mementos that we've hung in there of fear, of disappointment. And we've got to get rid of them. And the only way to get rid of them is to get the King of Glory in them to deliver you. Can I say this to you? Would you be willing, if I could lay hands on you — I'm not saying I'm going to, I'm saying if I could lay hands on you and I guaranteed you that I could anoint you with oil, lay hands on you and pray for you, and every bad memory you have in your head would be gone, would you be willing to do it? Yes. Would you really? Yes. And then when somebody comes up and said, "Weren't you?" And you were like, listen, let me ask you this. How many memories would you have left? I mean, erased it. "Who are you?" "I don't know." "Where were you born?" "I don't know. I just remember it was traumatic when I came out." Think about it, church. Every memory that's a painful memory, erased. See, sometimes, because we don't have good memories, then we take the bad memories and we elevate them to glory status. I'll give you for instance. Okay, I had a very good childhood. Had great parents, had the greatest childhood a kid could ever have. I was raised on a ranch out in the middle of thousands of acres. Got to go do what I wanted to. Learned to hunt and shoot and all this kind of stuff. My father, he was a gunsmith, and so I was raised around all these fine custom rifles and guns. We had this huge gun collection because my father collected guns. And my father also collected shells. And so, not seashells. Cartridges. And he kind of prided himself that he had all these cartridges. You'd pick these things up. Remember, he had the big 500 Nitro Expresses, and he had all these rare cartridges and all these things. And so as a kid, I used to go play with them. Well, you know, when you're a kid, you're looking at them, you know, and they're just, you know, one size shell or a bigger shell or whatever, you know, you don't know. But as I grew up and learned about all the shells and learned what all they were, you know, it was really a pretty good collection. Well, the other day, a person came to me and said, he wanted to show me a shell collection. He knew I was interested in guns and stuff like that. He had no idea of what I had seen in life. And so he showed me a shell collection, you know, and I wanted to laugh. I wanted to say, "Man, you know, I mean, dude, I guess you got to start somewhere. But, I mean, you can get most of those at Walmart. I mean, you know, they ain't very rare." I looked down on it. You see what I'm saying? Because I had seen the glory. So I was not impressed with his collection. He was impressed with it because that's all he had. We have got to quit taking the fearful and the things that we think, "Well, one time, you know, I was run over by a truck, went through all the back wheels, and, you know, I'm still here." And that's what we hang on. We weren't killed. I mean, praise God. But would it have not been a better testimony? I was there, and I was about to get hit by a truck, and I prayed, and an angel moved me, and it went right past me. You follow me? Church, we can't take, we don't want those life experiences in our barn that are painful, just survived images and memories, and keep that up there elevated because it's not a very good one. Let's get a new one. The time God delivered me. The time I saw the waters parted. The time I saw God move when no one could have done it. And start getting rid of those and hanging those up. You say, well, I don't have any yet. Well, get one today. You got to start right now. You got to open the doors of your barn and say, I want the King of Glory to come in. Lord, show me. And I want to tell you something, folks. He will. He will. Y'all ever seen that? That it's a cartoon where there's a big, it's a old cartoon where there's this big, I don't know, I think it's a dog, and he's driving a post in the ground, and he's hitting, and then there's a little one that jumps up, bam, hits it and jumps back off, and the big one hits, and they're trying to do this. Y'all seen that? Y'all know what I'm talking about? And then all of a sudden they get out of sync and that's what it's like. Get out of the way. Let the big God do it, and you quit trying to help. Because somewhere along the way, you're going to get smushed. Somewhere along the way, you're going to get out of sync. Somewhere along the way, you're just going to be in the way. God's about to move his hand, and then here comes yours. God's about to write something on the table of your heart with his finger, and then yours gets in there. Let the King of Glory come in. Let me give you one more scripture here. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation 3 and 20. Now this is a promise to you. Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Jesus is speaking. It's in red. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. The promise I have for you today is, if you would be willing to lose your fearful mementos, your fearful thoughts, your fearful trophies, and be willing to replace those with God-inspired supernatural victories, then he's standing at the door of your heart today knocking. And if you'd say, Lord, I'll throw open the doors to my barn. I want the King of Glory to come in. Not just the King of Glory. I'm talking about the King of Glory to come in. You know, you got to throw a little, I mean, he's the God of prosperity. He's the God of dignity. He's the God of reputation. He's the God of abundance. He's the God of riches. That guy to come into your barn and to fill it. Then, folks, you need to get up in the mornings and you need to throw open your door and say, Lord, here I am. I'm throwing open my doors to you today. He said, well, you know, sometimes I just like to pray silently for just a minute and meditate and pray. Say, Jesus, help me today. You say, well, that's the way I was taught. Well, you need to quit. I'm just telling you honestly, you need to quit. It's time to get vocal in life. It's time to stand and say, well, I don't know what to say. Just go get hold of Psalms 34. Just break out Psalms 27. Just start reading it out loud like it means something to you. Stand up and say, Lord, today as I go out this day. I mean, you can write this one down if you want to. Lord, today as I go out this day, I open up the barn doors and I say, let the King of Glory come in. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world, and I'm going to walk with you today, Lord. I mean, that's a great way to start the day out. It's like I've always told you, you can be your own person, all right? Listen to me, you can be your own person. You don't have to go Pentecostal. Sometimes it feels good. It's like I said, it's like cussing in word. Yeah, foul devil, in the name of Jesus. Do you think you're going to mess with me? I mean, it feels good sometimes. You just need to like vent and get it out. Rather than just saying, oh, Lord, I'm so frustrated. I'm so tired. I don't know what I'm going to do. Oh, God, help me, please, Jesus. I mean, you just need to, whoa. It's good. You say, well, everybody, I think I'm crazy. You already came to church here, so they already think you are crazy, so it doesn't make any difference. All right? So what's the big deal? All right? It don't make no difference. Quit being embarrassed. Quit being out thinking, oh, well, this or that or the other. Well, I'm just not that kind of a person. Well, you're going to have to get that kind of way. Or otherwise, you're going to keep getting run over. And you're going to keep getting full of fearful thoughts. And you need to go back and you say, Lord, I don't want to ever think like that again. I'm believing you. I am a believer. Everybody say, I'm a believer. You need to get it down in your heart. Yes. Say, I'm believing the Word of God. Well, I don't know if Jesus will do that. Listen, believing for everything and let Him sort it out. How's that? I mean, that's really simple. Well, will God fix my car? I don't know. Pray. He says He wants to provide for you. He said He wants to bless you. He wants to give you something. I don't know if He's going to fix your car, give you a new one, get somebody to do this. This is going to happen or that. I don't know how it's going to work, but I just know He wants to prosper you. I can promise you that. There's enough scripture and places in that He wants to prosper you. How's it going to get done? I don't know. I had heard a story one time from a lady who told me, she said, my car wouldn't start. And I said, well, what did you do? And she said, I just marched around it 7 times like they did in the days of Jericho and commanded it to start. And I said, did it start? And she said, well, no. And I said, hey, at least you got some exercise. And she said, yeah, it was kind of fun. I said, well, then what happened? He said, well, a friend came to the house and he jump started and got it going. Oh, well, that was just a friend. I wanted to see God supernatural. Well, who are you? Your car got started. You got some exercise. Got something stirring on the inside of you. Used your vocal cords a little bit. Marched around your car 7 times. You follow me? But the car got started. That same person told me that they were tired of having a car that wouldn't start. Not having a good car. This is a true story. They used to go to church here years and years ago. They got tired of a car not starting, not having a good car. And they just kept praying, kept saying, what do we do? And I said, well, just pray. I mean, God will do something. And so one day they come and tell me, he said, you're not going to believe this. And I said, what? He said, my husband just got an opportunity. He used to be a long-haul truck driver. And he got out of the business, and he just got a friend called and has a truck, and he wants him to go into that and wants him to go back into the trucking business, and it looks like a good opportunity. We're going to do that. So they ended up leaving the church here. And so, you know, I kept in contact with him for a while, and then after he was, you know, okay, remember, the car wouldn't start. This is the same lady, marched around it 7 times. Vehicles were important to him. They were praying about a vehicle. They end up in a truck. And a few years later, they call me and say, man, we're doing so good. We're prospering. We just listen. We're going down the road all the time, listening to Jesus on the radio and just praying. Says, God has so delivered us from those days. He says, now we own our own trucking. So what I'm saying is, see, she started out marching around the car 7 times and ended up owning a long-haul truck. It didn't happen. She didn't say, I need something. And there it was. No, it took some time. But as they persevered and kept going on and let the King of Glory fill their barns, he did. You see, church, we've got to get out of Merlin the Magician and the, you know, rubbing the magic genie. God is not a magic genie. He's the God of glory. He's the King of Glory. And he will move and he will work in your life, but he just wants you to be a believer and stay with him. So that when the time he's worked through all the mess and got the victory and he comes back to give it to you, you're still there. Some people he can't find when he's got it. He's like, where'd they go? What happened to him? I had it. Here's the victory. Because they gave up. Because they didn't see anything quick enough. And they ran off. And they lost it. Just wake up every morning and say, Lord, I just want the King of Glory to fill my barn. Amen? And watch what he does in your life. Be a believer. Amen? Stand to your feet. Lord, come up here and just do your thing for a second. I want to pray for you, but only you know your heart. Only you know how this message is speaking to you. I'm not looking for any kind of certain response, because I must believe in God that the King of Glory will fill your barn if you throw open your doors. I'm telling you, if you hear Him knocking on your heart today, it's time to throw open the doors and get rid of those fears. So I want you just to bow your heads and just to bow your hearts and just look on the inside of you. And if the Holy Spirit's speaking something to you right now, and you have an old fearful thought or a worry or a concern that's coming to your attention right now, well, He's wanting to get rid of that. And if you'll just, in your own way, just lift that up to the Lord and say, Lord, I want that out of my life. I'm going to pray a prayer and He'll deliver you right now. He'll deliver you right now. I promise you. If you're in there and you're watching by video or you're listening to this message right now, wherever you are, right now, just begin to lift up that fear, lift up that concern to the Lord right now. And you want the King of Glory to come in your barn, just lift it up right now, because when I pray this prayer, I don't care where you are, what time you're listening to this, God will come into your life and He'll set you free. He'll set you free. So Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I pray over every person here. All of those listening, all of those watching, that as they lift up that fearful thought to you, that concern, that worry right now, I pray over them that Jesus, the King of Glory, comes into their lives, comes into their barns right now, and delivers them. That, Lord, You set them free of that fearful thought. And we replace it, Lord, right now with the thought of the King of Glory coming into our lives. The God of riches, the God of abundance, the God of grace, the God of mercy, the God of love coming into our barns right now and setting us free, sitting down at the table with us and dining with us, that we get to have fellowship with the King of Glory. The King of Glory. Lord, I thank You right now that in the days ahead, that believers will rise up, and that this valley will be a valley full of believers. Lord, it'll be a valley full of believers in You. That, Lord, it'll cause heaven to rejoice, because there's so many of us down here trusting in You and believing in You. That this will truly be a valley of Your glory, that the King of Glory walks through. I thank You, Lord, for supernatural events taking place. I thank You for Your angels supernaturally moving in our lives, because You said they encamp around those who fear You. So, Lord, right now the angels are encamping around those that fear You. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Just begin to thank Him there in your heart, church, and just tell Him. Just say, thank You, Jesus. You're so amazing. Just thank Him. He's the God who heals you. He's the God who delivers you. He's the God who sets you free. That you are a believer. He's an amazing God. He's the King of Glory. Now, if you're in here today or you're listening or watching and you don't have a relationship with Jesus, you're not sure today if you died you'd go to heaven. You don't know if He is your Lord and Savior. The Bible is real simple. It says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart in Jesus, that He's the Son of God, that He died on a cross for you to forgive you of your sins. But if you'd believe in that, then you're saved. It's not your church attendance. It's not your record of good doing and good deeds. It's your faith in believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So if you're in here today, matter of fact, let me have my prayer team just come down. If you're here on the prayer team today, just come down up front. If you're in here today and you don't know for sure if you died that you'd go to heaven, I got a prayer team right here to pray for you. If you're out there listening or watching and you're not sure, well, then you need to pray and you need to say, Jesus, come into my heart. I want you to forgive me of my sins. Wash me in your blood. Make me whole. Make me new. Make heaven my home. And when you sincerely pray that from your heart, He will set you free. He'll bless you. But if you're in here today and you're just not sure about your salvation, or you want to rededicate your life, we're here, up here to pray with you. If you need prayer for anything else going on in your life, or any issue you want to pray, we're here to pray with you because I know prayer works. The Bible says if two of us come in agreement upon anything, God will do it. God will do it. Amen? So look at the person next to you and say, man, I like the King of Glory. So church, go out there this week and be believers. Tell people the good news about Jesus. Those people you come across and you run across that are full of doubt and unbelief, stop them and say that you need to meet the King of Glory. And then tell them about Jesus. Amen? Let's change what's going on around here. Amen? And you just always remember this. You're not called to be perfect. You're just called to be a good preacher. Jesus is perfect. Amen? Amen. So take the hand of the person beside you there. Now, Lord, as we leave this building today, I just pray for each person that we'll go out there this week. We're going to run across people that know you. We're going to run across people that don't know you. And Lord, we're just going to be preachers. We're going to tell them all the good news about Jesus. So Lord, bless that person on our left and our right. Bless this week. Lord, just let your face shine upon them and give them peace. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. God bless you, church. We're here for you up front if you need prayer.